Welcome everyone, welcome to our new edition of interviews. I have so many special guests and they have so much knowledge to share with you. And today our special guest is Madhurima Sapati. Madhurima is a burnout soul coach from India. She helps creatives, solopreneurs and coaches conquer their callings by helping them overcome and prevent burnouts. She loves to focus on all the reasons that can lead to burnout, like mindset blocks, limitations, blurry boundaries, and work-life balance, to name just a few. Her mission as a burnout soul coach is to convert toxic work environments into healthy workplaces by raising awareness around burnout with the help of coaching. The ultimate aim is to enable those who are shaping not only our future, but also our present. And if she can enable even a handful of them to continue sharing their creative and innovative perspective with the world, that's enough. This is very impressive and I am very, very excited. Thank you so much for being with me on this journey. I love your bio and I love your mission. I believe that so many of us need this. And I have been in that situation so many times in a burnout. I didn't know what to do. I was lost and confused. Thank you so much for being with me on this journey.
Thank you for having me here.
I would like to ask you right away, Madhurima, what is your story? How did you end up on this path of helping other people really identify their struggles and the reasons why they are in burnout?
So it's actually a very funny story, to be honest. Earlier on, I had just a side hobby of helping people with anxiety tips and stuff like that. And this was pre-pandemic, but during the pandemic, I have health anxiety and I was completely wrecked, to be honest. And I realized that I was not in a position to be helping people overcome anxiety when I was going through anxiety and had no idea how to overcome it because of the environment that we were in, right? Like, we couldn't remove ourselves from that environment. And so I was like, okay, you know what? I have to hit pause. I hit pause and then I went back to helping people with anxiety after a couple of months. But I had a lot of people reach out to me with anxiety stuff and issues. And I was like, okay, you know, I'm not a therapist. I don't have a proper degree, medical degree in it. And I was like, what do I do? What can I do? So I was like, I hit pause again. And then I was like, you know what? Spirituality was something that helped me personally with anxiety. And I decided to help people at least anchor themselves down and find themselves, because I felt like towards the end of 2020, a lot of us were lost with having no idea as to how we are supposed to go ahead. Where were we in our personal journeys? And that's how spirituality came into being. And this year, I think in March, I was a part of a 5-day challenge held by Preston Smiles. And it was during that time that I decided to niche down and help people going through burnout, because I had personally been through burnouts right about every single time I was working in any workplace, whether it was a big agency or a small agency, I was going through a burnout. And I realized that there were a lot of toxic work situations that was happening, right? Like, people don't really talk about it a lot, right? Like, and they don't want to work on it, because if they work on it, that means that they're aware and they have been aware about it, and they just like will ignore it till it goes away kind of a situation. So I was like, okay, if I can't help big agencies, let me help one person. Like, if I can help even a single person navigate, overcome and prevent burnouts in the future by creating systems that works for them, I think there's nothing more beautiful than that. And that's how my journey has taken me where I am right now.
Thank you so much, Madhurima. This is impressive. And I know that I have been in this situation so many times, and I have experienced feelings of, I don't know, not really knowing how to get out of situation, putting too much pressure on myself. And I would like to ask you, do you think this is specific to certain categories of people, like overachievers, for example, people who are too committed? Or do you think this can happen to everyone? And how can we get out of that burnout situation? What is the trigger that we can see right away that we are not well? We are going to go into a burnout.
Yes, that's a wonderful question. And to answer your question, I would like to say this, okay, right? So I always say this, spirituality is not something that is similar to everyone. My version of spirituality might be completely different to your version of spirituality. I find being spiritual equals to reading books and stuff like that, or just dancing alone in my room, or singing at the top of my voice. And that might be my version of spirituality. Yours might be completely different. It's completely unique to our being, right? And that's what is the same thing with burnouts. Like, the reasons I might be going through burnout might not be similar to the reasons that you are going through a burnout. And so it differs from one person to one person, to every individual. And so I believe that everyone can go through a burnout, but their burnout might look completely different from yours. So there are a few basic steps, basic things, right, that we can do to kind of prevent this burnout situation. And again, it's a very generalistic viewpoint. It depends from person to person. But I believe that, and I talk about this a lot, regular rests every single day. And why I want to say this is because we have this mentality where rest becomes reward. And what that means is, if I work for 5 continuous days and if I achieve my goals and targets for this particular week, only then am I going to rest, and only then am I going to enjoy. And this can be a subconscious thing, right? Like, we are not even saying it out loud. It becomes something that's like, okay, yeah, we are going to enjoy stuff, we are going to watch our favorite movies, and we are going to do this and this and this, but only if we finish this. And it becomes very it becomes like a situation which has to have a precursor to it. Something has to happen for rest to happen. And I always say this, that you don't have to do that. If you are taking rest every single day, and it doesn't have to be like 6 hours of rest, right? It has to be like, if you're working for an hour, or if you are doing a 2-hour work sprint, you can have a 30-minute break where you just like, and relax and let your mind just calm down. And I say this also, right? If our engine is overheating, if we relate that to a car's engine, if a car's engine is overheating, the one thing that you can do if you don't have any other resources is to just shut it down for some time. The more you work it, I'm just gonna push it for like 1 kilometer or 2 more kilometers till I reach the garage. You don't know what is going to happen in that 2 kilometers, how much more damage is happening. And so I always say this, take regular rests every single day. And that rest can be anything for you. Again, individual perceptions, right? Like, my version of rest might not be similar to your version of rest. And so the second thing that I would recommend to someone is to be in awareness of who they are, right? Like, what do they find joy in? What causes stress? Create a list of triggers that might cause you stress. Things that might have happened in your past that might have led you to a burnout. Create a list. Okay, what caused that? What caused that? Ask a list of questions and reach to the source and note down the source, so that when that source happens again, when that trigger is happening again, you're like, hold on a minute, I'm just going to hit pause right now. And this is something that has caused me to burn out in the past. And so I'll take appropriate measures to prevent a similar situation from happening. And I think that are two ways I think that people could definitely try. Again, there are multiple, depending on what your trigger is. That's why coaching is again a part of it, because I don't do group coaching calls. I just do one-on-one coaching calls, mostly because I realize that, you know, my version might be completely different to your version of it. So to help someone completely would be to sit down with them and actually work with them together to find out what is their triggers and what they can do to help overcome it. So yeah.
I love that. Thank you so much, Madarima. And I so much don't do this. And exactly what you explained, actually, that you just want to finish this task and then to get the rest, right? So you're not really putting yourself in the situation to say, okay, now I need some rest because I am tired and I am going to stop. It's always like, okay, let me just finish this and then I can have the right to rest.
Yeah. Yeah.
And this is really a mindset that needs to change. There has to be a switch. And my question would be for those who are in this situation, because I know I have been in the past in this situation in my career. I know that people who are working in an environment where there are many demands and expectations, they maybe don't believe in resting. And it happened to me also that I am taking the rest, but I am feeling guilty and I am feeling like, okay, maybe I should go back. So it doesn't really help. How can we do actually that? How can we really take that time and to find that balance between life and work, between ourselves and the tasks from our job?
I love that question a lot. And there are two answers to this, and I'll give you both the answers. And you this is something that's a part of my coaching program, and I've never really said it out loud, but I'm just going to share it here so that as many people can hear it, should hear it. The one thing that we need to understand is we are not just one entire being, right? There are different aspects of us. There are different personalities of us. We are not just one particular being. And what happens usually, especially if we are workaholics, especially if we love work, especially something we enjoy, what happens is it becomes our entire personality. Our work self becomes our entire personality. And what it does is it prevents any other self to come up, right? For example, if I want to, I love creating and I'm like, okay, I love coaching and stuff like that. But then if I sit down and I'm like, you know what, today I'm going to sit down and read a book because I love reading books. My work self will be like, you can't, because you have to coach people and you have to help people. So you shouldn't be reading books. You should be going out there and you should be getting in the battlegrounds and doing stuff, right? Like, you can't do this. And so my work self will be like, oh yeah, that makes a lot of sense. My internal self becomes my work self and it becomes, okay, yeah, that makes a lot of sense. I am going to work. I am going to do this and XYZ, you know, like there are a lot of excuses that comes up every time any other self tries to be like, I need help. No, you don't. I need to focus on work, right? Our priorities shift. And the reason why this also happens is I was reading this book called How to Do Nothing by Jenny. Oh, I forget her last name. But she said this and it made a lot of sense. And it's something that I believe as well. Over the past few years, we have had this concept of time is value. Time is money. Time is everything. Every second needs to be accounted for. And so when we are resting, we are basically doing nothing. And that's why the guilt starts to come up and, you know, you just go, I can't rest because I'm doing nothing. You know, the time is not accounted for. What can I do? I shouldn't be doing this. I should go back to work and I should work, work, work. And this concept is fed by our work self. And this concept also feeds our work self, right? So it's like both of them shook hands and they're like, work. That's all that matters. And so I just wanted to say this. And this is also something similar to what we were speaking in the previous question. Don't reach or don't wait for rock bottom to happen before you start taking care of yourself, right? And a lot of us have this concept, right? Like, it's not that worse. It's not that bad. When it's bad, we'll take care of it or we'll look into it. But that's the thing. You don't have to wait for rock bottom because you don't want to know what that rock bottom is. Sometimes we reach that rock bottom and we don't realize it because we keep thinking that there's something worse that can happen. And so this is not a priority. And that's when we have to kind of like hit stop. And this can happen at any point of your journey. A lot of people ask me and talk to me and they're like, we have been workaholics for 7 years or 12 years. We can't do this right now. It doesn't matter at what point of your journey you are in. It's that awareness. Once that awareness is there, it's like this nagging thing inside your mind, right? Like, you are ignoring me and you're conscious and aware that you're ignoring this part of you that wants that help. And so again, it's like, doesn't matter where you are in your journey. You're aware that you want help, so seek it. Ask for help. It can be coaches. You know, it just doesn't have to be me alone. Like, there are a lot of people who can help you out. There are a lot of books, a lot of podcasts, lots of things are available to you. We are living in a world which, you know, we are living in the digital era of the world where we are connecting from completely different parts of the world right now while doing this podcast. So nothing is impossible. It's just this mindset and this fear that we can't change now because we have been living in this world and in this particular environment for so long that the moment we change, we don't know what's going to happen. It's the unknown. And so we are scared of it. And so we go back into the comfort zone, even if it hurts. So, yeah.
Thank you, Madhurima. Absolutely. I fully agree with you. And I also believe that we are in an era where more and more people are starting to be aware of what they are feeling, being aware of their emotions, their thoughts, and how they actually want to live their life. And this is also the reason why I created this brand, Design Tomorrow, because I believe we have the ability to design our life the way we want to. And this, the burnout, is absolutely essential for me, but also for other people, because I know that if we are constantly in that working mindset and not taking the time for ourselves, this impacts also other areas of our life. And I would like to ask you, do you think that our leadership skills, our way of doing or guiding our teams can be impacted by our mindset and our happiness?
I definitely believe that. So a part of my work is also to, like, this is something that I am working on right now, is to help leaders. And there's a reason for this, right? I'll take it the other way around. If our mindset, and this is just an example, if in our mind we are like, the world sucks, everything is bad and everyone is out to get you, our perspective, what we start to do is we start to look for confirmation for that, right? And this is a part of our it's a part of our programming, right? Of how we program our mind. And if in our mindset we are like, everyone's out to get you, everyone's bad, we start to look for confirmation from it, from around the world. Like, even if it doesn't exist, we'll be like, that person behaved like that, and that must mean that they're out to get me. Once that happens, once that confirmation is established, this becomes like a conviction, basically, of everyone is bad, everyone is out to get me. And so we start to view the world from that dark lens. When we are viewing the world from that dark lens, even if happiness comes and sits right in front of our face, we'll still be like, there must be something negative behind this, right? Like, there must be this must be a trap, basically. There must be something behind this. I can't have happiness because I don't deserve it, because everyone is bad and everyone is out to get me. So even if happiness comes and sits right in front of you, you are just going to be like, there's something behind this. I know it. I know that there's something like this that's going to happen. And so what happens then is that in a leadership position, we are all looking as a leader to guide people and all the people underneath them, not to be like, okay, this is what you have to do, not to order people. Leaders are supposed to guide them to the destination, right? But if a leader's kind of glass is darkened, right? Or let's say they're wearing dark sunglasses, they are going to view the world from that tinted thing. And even their guidance is going to have some sort of a bitter twist to it, or something that is just going to be like some catch, basically. And the leaders, what they will do is, because of that concept, of that mindset, is everyone is out to get me, a leader won't be a proper leader, because they won't give their all. They won't share everything that happens within them. They won't mentor people, because they will be like, I can't share everything, because if I share everything, this person is out to get me. This person is then going to become a leader, and I'm going to lose my job, and everyone's going to laugh at me. And you see that kind of steps that it takes, right? So if we switch that situation completely around, and if our mindset becomes, if we reprogram our mind to be like, no, the world may be negative, there might be bad guys out there, but the world is also positive. There are a lot of good things that is happening. And I have, as an intentional person, the choice to choose what I want to see in the world. Not in ignorance, in awareness. And what that means is, if a bad thing is happening, I'm not ignoring it. I'm in awareness of it, I'm dealing with it, but then I am going to go back to the happy place. I am going to look for happiness. And that perspective change, that reprogramming, will then change the way that they will view themselves, the world, and their leadership position. They will guide from a place of, if I give this thing to this person, they are going to help improve the company, improve themselves, and I'm going to learn from them. There is this thing in Hindi, I mean, in our country, where we always say that goddess Saraswati, the goddess of knowledge, sits on our tongue, right? And the more we share, the more we expand. It's not a treasure to be kind of locked down, thrown under the sea, covered with stuff and forgotten all about. It's something that the more you share, the more you hear, the more you learn, the more you share. So it's that cycle. And I feel like that is something that's extremely important.
I love this. Thank you so much, Madhurima. And you are providing so much valuable information. And I love your examples, because this makes it very clear for someone who is leading, whether the person is in a negative or a positive mindset, and the impact this can have, not only on the team, but also on organizations. And this is essential that everyone gets it and everyone understands it. And I know this takes time. And as you mentioned, we need sometimes support and coaches to go through this path and this journey. Thank you once again for building on all of this, on your experience and giving us your life lessons. I would like to ask you before we close our interview, who are you serving and how can people contact you?
Awesome. So right now, to be honest, I have kind of opened up my niche, mostly because I have seen a lot of people going through burnout but not being aware of what to do with it. And so while my primary niche continues to be creatives, entrepreneurs and coaches, and you know, in entrepreneurs, especially solopreneurs, because I believe that if you start right from the very beginning, there's no reason to look for the rock bottom again. I'm also available to help other people that fall into other categories, and yeah, and they can reach out to me on Instagram at Madhurima, that is MADHURIMA _ burnout soul coach. And that is like my number one place to reach out, because then it has my Linktree account in the bio, and that has all my resources. I have like a ton of resources, free, paid, my podcast that they can listen to called The Soul's Conquest, my YouTube channel called Mithwa, which basically means that I will be guiding them, being a friend for them and being a philosopher in that journey of life. And so they can reach out to me over there anywhere. But Instagram is the best place to connect, basically.
Thank you so much, Madhurima. For those of you listening to us, don't hesitate to contact her, because she's going to be there to support you and to transform your life. This is all it is. We can design our life. We don't have to live in a crazy world where we are constantly burned out. Thank you so much for being with me, Madhurima, on this journey, and dedicate your time to this interview.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
For those of you listening to us, stay connected, because there is so much more to come.